Enough has been written and said about Disneyland to fill a good-sized library. Nothing has quite captured the imagination, the charm, the three-dimensional fun and excitement such as Walt Disney's Magic Kingdom. In building his dream, Walt surrounded himself with talented artists, engineers, and designers, and formed Imagineering, the folks who continue to transform Disney dreams into reality. I'm Marnie McPhail. Now, I met up with one of the founding fathers of Disneyland, Imagineering artist Herb Ryman. And I asked him, what is his job?
Oh, it's indescribable. I couldn't describe it at all. Of course, Walt called it Imagineering, and I suppose that's as accurate a description of it as you could. It's visual Imagineering. And I have to draw, and I have to think in terms of fantasy. You also have to think in terms of what people would want. To give you a quick little example, one day I was very frustrated. I was sitting alone with something I was trying to do, and Walt came in and looked at it, and he said, I don't like that. And that means kill it, stop it, don't put any more time on it. And I was frustrated. I didn't like it either. But and then Walt started to walk out of the room. And I said rather peevishly to him, I said, well, why don't you give me some idea what you would like? Give me a clue to work with. And he turned around and he said, well, he said, just do something that everybody will like. And then he walked away.
Simple as that.
And I thought, now, isn't that nice? Just do something that everybody will like. Well, I wish I could have done that all my life.
Herb Ryman's work has pleased others all his life. He began as a motion picture story illustrator and worked on such classics as David Copperfield, Tale of Two Cities, and later, Anna and the King of Siam. He joined forces with Disney in 1938 and worked on story development and as a layout artist on Pinocchio, Fantasia, and as an art director on Dumbo. He accompanied Walt Disney on a goodwill tour of South America, which resulted in the animated films Saludos Amigos and The Three Caballeros.
We're three caballeros, three gay caballeros. They say we are birds of a feather.
At the personal invitation of John Ringling North, Herb traveled with the greatest show on earth for a couple of years and rendered the glamorous and the not so glamorous behind the scenes of the circus. He has traveled to exotic locales the world over, transforming life, place, and time into compelling expressions of color, form, and emotion. However, even with all his worldly artistic experience, Herb was not quite prepared when Walt Disney called him into the studio one Saturday morning to discuss a new project called Disneyland.
He said, my brother Roy has to go to New York on Monday morning, and he's got to show the bankers what we're going to do.
Right.
And he said, you know how bankers are. He said, they don't have any imagination. And he said, Roy has got to show them what I'm going to do. And he's got to show them all these drawings that are designs for the park. And I said, oh, that's the, of course, naturally. Well, I want to see them. Where are they? And he said, and he pointed at me and he said, you're going to do them.
Walt and Herb spent that weekend together, which resulted in this drawing of Disneyland. It sold the $17 million project to the bankers.
What's this here?
Marty, this is the original Disneyland castle. It was built at this scale, as we built all of our models. And this is the way it looks today. But it didn't always look like this. There was a day when the part facing Fantasyland faced the front. I came in one day and I looked at it and I thought, that looks quite a bit like the Neuschwanstein castle in the Mad King Ludwig's Bavaria. And I thought I'd experiment with it, and I turned it around, and at that moment Walt was standing behind me and he said, oh, I like that a lot better. So that's the way it got built. The castle in Florida was $17 million. And this whole Disneyland of course, was built for less money than that when it started.
From artist rendering to scale model to construction and to the finished product, Disneyland opened exactly 1 year after the first shovel plowed into Anaheim soil.
Everything was done with tremendous enthusiasm and excitement. We worked 7 days a week. We came in on Monday morning and we worked right straight through, usually all day Sunday too. And Walt was the conductor of this symphony orchestra.
Because of deadlines during the initial design of Disneyland, Imagineering artists often had only a few hours to do their work before someone would snatch it from their easel. Many of the paintings that shape the look of the park are currently on display in the new Disney Art Gallery in Disneyland's New Orleans Square.
The development of New Orleans Square as it is today came about through a rearrangement of the structure of the plan. Meaning that we have a street coming in and you don't know where you're going to turn, and you turn and then first thing you know, you're right back where you started again. Strangely enough, it took about 2 years in its evolution.
Herb was recently honored when his 1964 painting of New Orleans Square was selected as the first Disney artwork to travel to the U.S. Embassy in Paris as part of the Art and Embassies program.
I was originally called upon to name some of the nomenclature for Tom Sawyer Island. Walt came to me and he said, Herbie, would you think of some names? Naturally, you obviously think about Smuggler's Gulch and Robber's Cove and inspiring names that little children would be excited about. And then later, one day, as Bill Cottrell told me, he said he and Walt rode around on the Mark Twain, and Walt had this map in front of him where these names were allocated as according to my designation. And Walt said, well, why should we let Herbie name all these names on the island? He said, well, why can't I name these? And Bill said, yes, he said, I think you could. And so Walt renamed all these names.
What do those names on the Main Street windows mean?
Well, the names on the Main Street windows are the people to whom Walt wished to give credit, people who helped him create Disneyland. For instance, there's a wonderful name up there. It's my friend Ken Anderson. He sells bait and tackle. And of course, Ken is one of the great fly fishermen in America. My name is there with John Hinch and with Peter Ellenshaw. And so we give art lessons. My work with Walt Disney fitted right in with my aims of trying to translate beauty and inspiration to people. And there's more of an extensive mission that has been accomplished by the work I've done here for Disneyland and for Walt Disney than anything I could have done as a private artist, because I would have had a very limited audience. But here at Disneyland, it's a world audience. So what better showcase could an artist have?